We need Jesus every day. Lord, I love Jesus every day. Holy my spirit so I can pray, so I can walk right, so I can talk right. Lord, I need Jesus every day. Lord, I need Jesus every day. All in our spirit, so I can pray, so I can walk right, so I can talk right. Lord, I need Jesus every day. Give the Lord a standing ovation. Everybody get up your comfort zone, rock, give me a little fellowship music right quick. Hug somebody, kiss somebody, come closer to the front. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The little voice I had to use it to sing song. Give the Lord a hand praise. I honor the Lord for Wednesday night Bible class. I thank God for those of you that had a mind to come out to the house of prayer and to be on time. I thank God for everything that God is doing in our midst. I give him praise, I give him honor, and I give him glory. And generally before we start our Bible classes, we allow 5 to 7 minutes for any questions that you may have. So if there are any questions, feel free to ask at this time. Are there any questions? All right. We're going to start with our Bible class. And on last Wednesday, I was not here. So this word that I have for you tonight, I want you to hear what thus saith the Lord. Because the scripture says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord. Now, how many remember this subject, a call from within? A call from within. Now, the scripture tells us, let him that hath a what? An ear, hear what the Spirit of the Lord hath to say. And hearing what the Lord hath to say to us determines not only our quality of life, but whether we live or die. Because the scripture tells us, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord. Now, our base scripture, Sister Shan, you got this scripture for me. Proverbs 23 and verse 7. Proverbs 23 and verse 7. When it comes to our thinking process, when it comes to our thinking process, we make decisions on knowledge that we have collected, correct? We often make decisions based on past experience. Is there anybody in this audience that has ever made a decision based on past experience? All of us have. We make decisions based on past experience. So now, when we make decisions based on past experience, nine times out of ten, we make these decisions concerning individuals. Now, if an individual, if you've had a conflict with an individual in the past, if you've had a conflict with an individual in the past, and they come from you, come at you at a different angle, there's always this possibility. There's a possibility, number one, that nothing has changed. There's a possibility that nothing has changed. The next thing is that there's the possibility that old wounds will be reopened. Wow. There's a possibility that nothing has changed and that old wounds will be reopened. And there's a third risk. And that third risk is this: the risk of responding in a negative manner or leaving feeling re-depressed. Now, what do I mean by that? If an individual I wish I had a teenage male in here. I ain't got nobody to help me. Go get me one right quick. If an individual makes decisions based on those three criteria, is that okay? Raise your hand. Why'd you say no? All right, she said you may have unforgiveness. Did everybody hear the responses? All right. Number one, when it comes to us making decisions, the Bible says, in all thy getting, to get an understanding. And nine times out of ten, we make decisions based on stored data. And let's use, for an example, a person that you have had a conflict with in the past. You run the risk of three things happening. Number one, you run the risk, there's always a possibility that nothing has changed. And we always want to avoid the same old, right? Number two, there is the risk of old wounds being reopened. And number three, the risk of responding in a negative manner or leaving feeling re-depressed. So now, is that okay? April said no, because it has a tendency to allude that you have not forgiven the individual. Don't y'all be scared. Is that okay? All right. Anybody else? We'd be stuck in the same spot. Yes, ma'am. Okay, listen to what I'm saying. We make decisions, and I'm using for an example, we make decisions based on stored data, stored knowledge, stored information. And I'm using an example, a person that you have had, stand up. What's the name? Jermaine and I have had conflicts in the past. Push me back. We've had conflicts in the past. So now, that's stored data. I know Jermaine will fight back. He pushed me back, I pushed him. So there's obviously known conflict. Now, let's fast forward. Here's 2 years down the road. I run into Jermaine. And immediately, it's fresh in my mind, the conflict that we had, right? So now, to stop and chat with him, I run the risk of these three things. Number one, nothing has changed. What was number two?
Open old wounds.
Huh?
You open
up old wounds. And what's number three? You leave feeling re-depressed. And when you re-depress, that's depression on top of depression. And you suppress, depressed, and oppressed. Do you not know? Just by the mere fact I'm using this example, running to this individual, you can be doing fine, and it can cloud up a sunshiny day. It clouds up a sunshiny day. Now, is it okay to think that way? You raise your hands. Yes. Did you hear the scenario? All right, I'm going to do this last time. We make decisions based on stored data. We make decisions based on a collection of information of past experience. The example is this here. Jermaine and I have had a conflict in the past. We're going to fast forward 2 years down the road. Now, to engage in conversation with Jermaine 2 years down the road, doesn't matter if it's the same setting or a different setting, I run the risk of three things happening. Number one, nothing has changed. Number two, opening up old wounds. And number three, engaging with them, I may leave feeling re-depressed. What you mean? I was depressed and I was upset and it caused a whole lot of emotional conflict because of the situation I went through with him. So now, I can be having a beautiful, wonderful, glorious, sunshiny day. But after running to him, all of those old feelings come right back. Is it okay to think that way? Yes, sir. Why not?
Doing, you're judging him on past feelings.
All right. Anybody else? All right.
I said, no, sir, in that you may need deliverance and you hadn't had deliverance from the past, but you still holding to that person, if I'm hearing you right.
So, Jackie, is it okay to think that way? Huh? Oh, give it a mic.
Okay, let me understand what you're asking.
Okay.
I know you said you weren't going to do it again, but you're saying, is it okay to hold or to have those feelings when you run into Jermaine, knowing your past with Jermaine?
I've run into him 2 years after the initial conflict.
Correct.
I've run into him 2 years. I'm running the risk of one of three things happening because I'm basing it on what happened with us in the past.
Correct.
Number one, nothing has changed. Number two, what was it, opening up?
Old wounds.
And number three, if I engage with them, I'm gonna become re-depressed like I was when we first had the conflict. So is it okay for me to guard my feelings and feel that way and see him coming and go to the other side of the street?
I think you should at least speak, even if you don't hold a conversation. Speak to him and keep moving.
Now, if I speak to him, we're going to engage in conversation. All right. Go ahead, sir.
I have a question that's in your question. What if we got into a conflict and got into sin with Jesus, and we got down on our knees to repent, and Jesus didn't forgive us because he thought you were going to do the same thing over again? Mm.
Sister Jackie, it's the only way I'm going to avoid, the only way I'm going to avoid the contact is to cross and go to the other side of the street. Is that okay? Now, I'm not going to let you speak and move on. Huh? How's what possible? I'm not going to let you speak and move on. No, I wouldn't. I could follow you to the other side of the street and gave you the conflict. You remember that conflict we had 2 years ago? How we got to fight in the same jail cell. You remember? And you're trying to get away, but I'm still engaged in the conversation. And so just by that, your heart go to beating fast. You wish I would just go on and leave you alone. Yes, sir. So is it okay to think to avoid these three potentials, even if I try to speak and just, I don't want to talk to you, just let me go to the other side of the street, leave me alone. Is that all right? Yes, sir.
Okay, for one, you can't run away from your past. So I say you should go ahead and speak to the person, but you got to make sure that you have forgiveness in your heart. And also, you got to, when you talk to the person, you got to judge the spirit of the person, because the spirit of the person 2 years ago might not be in the person no more.
Now, how is that going to be determined? That's what I'm getting at.
You have to engage in conversation.
How is it going to be determined whether or not this individual has changed? Now, what Sister Jackie said, she would just speak and go on. Sister Hazel said, I followed to the other side. She said, I wish you'd just gone back to the other side of the street. So how was it going to be determined whether or not they changed? Because what Elder Porter said is exactly what Sister Jackie is saying. She knew what happened in the past. So what's she going to do? She's going to speak and keep on moving. She's not going to take that chance. Am I making sense? Mm-hmm. We do it every day. We do it every day. Every day. I ain't talking about, can I say this and get away with it? I'm talking about church folk. We do it every day. So how is it going to be determined whether or not this individual has changed if we avoid the contact? Yes, ma'am.
Pastor, I say no because.
No what?
When you ask the question about is it right, is it okay, I said to avoid that person. I said no because I have forgiven that person and I have forgot what happened in those 2 years. So I'm carrying it in my heart.
So you're guarding your heart.
I'm guarding my heart.
So avoid them.
Yeah. What I'm saying is that when you ask the question, is it all right to avoid this person?
Uh-huh.
I'm saying, because I haven't let go. See, that person could have let go, but I haven't let it go, and I'm still holding it when I see that person.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, my.
So you're going to speak and go to the other side of the street with Jackie?
I'm not going to speak.
Yes, sir.
what point did I forgive that situation? I never know about what his action, because I got to make sure that I'm okay first. Then with me being okay first, then however he handled that situation will be up to him. Even if I speak to that person or whatever I need to do with that person, if I'm not in my own heart have forgiven that person, then it's going to be all in vain anyway. So I need to make sure that at what point that I have forgiven that situation. I have.
You and Brother Jenkins, you epitomizing what I'm trying to get us to see. Because we can come to church year in, year out, have a conflict with an individual on the other side of the church and speak and keep on going and never deal with the issue. Never deal with the issue. So the question is, number one, the Bible does say, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. But watch this. It's talking about what you hear, what you allow to come into your spirit. It's not, it's how shall I say this here? Huh? To do what? No, that's, you don't have to have the Holy Ghost forgive. You don't have to have the Holy Ghost forgive. I'm talking about life in general. But we do this every day. And the Bible says, what does scripture say?
For as he thinketh in his heart, so
as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. If we make decisions, based on the same data, we're going to get the same results, right? If he lied to me in the past, he's going to lie to me in the future. If he treated me wrong in the past, he's going to treat me wrong today. What is that? Stored data, right? Now, what God causes to happen, God will cause things to happen not only to help this individual, but to help you with something that you don't know about yourself. He will. He will. An individual asked the question, and we had a record break service last night. Then with Sister Deborah. And am I on the air, Brother Rod? I can't say it on the air, but we had a wonderful time. I'm gonna tell y'all after we get off the air. They did something last night they never did before, but we thank God for it, don't we, Sister Deborah? So now, in this conflict resolution, when it comes to the way that we resolve conflict, I'm afraid to say, but it's true, a lot of us would rather just not deal with it and hope that it go away. Does it go away? Does it go away? It don't go away. So since it's not going to go away, now what Elder Porter said, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Individuals use that scripture. They use that scripture to guard their feelings. Are your feelings your heart? Help us, Holy God. Huh? Are your feelings your heart? Now, we make decisions on three different levels. Watch this. The Bible says we are created in the image and in the glory of who? God. So now, we make decisions on three different levels. We can make it from a natural standpoint, a spiritual standpoint, or from, how shall I word this one? Can I say the human psyche? The human psyche. Natural, spirit, and from the soul. Let me say it like that. That's perfect. Now, when it comes to the human spirit, the first law of the jungle when it comes to human is self-preservation. The flesh loves itself. It looks out for its own protection, its own well-being, its own pleasure. When it comes to the natural human spirit, there's either a male spirit or a female spirit. God does not give in between spirits. It's either male or female. So now, when it comes to us making decisions, watch this here. There is a different psychic when it comes to making decisions from the female perspective to the male perspective. Different psychic. Different psychic. Which one is easier to forgive, males or female?
Males.
Huh? On the natural side.
Males.
Wait, now y'all be honest. Yes, ma'am. Hold up, hold up, hold up. Y'all raise your hand. Where is that, Sister April? Ooh, Lord, who forgive quicker? It depends on the individual. I guess y'all heard that. I saw your hand. Yes, sir. Hold up, hold up. Listen, listen.
No, since you jumped in this.
Get your mic.
No, deal with something else. You had got on, you jumped surgery on me, so I left it alone.
Go ahead, come on, bring it back.
I was going back to when you said that crossing the street deal. Well, I remember when you was talking about in the past, you said that if a person had did me wrong, that person needs a ride. Mm-hmm. I would get that person a ride, but he got to get out of my car.
When they get to where you going?
Yeah, you said that one time. You said dealing with the situation, you said forgiving a person.
Yeah.
What you talking about now?
Right.
And we said that you said that, well, if a person had did me wrong, or killed me in a certain way, but that person needs a ride. If I see that person walk, I get that person a ride.
Yeah.
But that person, when he get to where he's going, he got to get out of my car.
Right.
But you didn't go out and eat dinner with him.
No.
So that same thing as you saying, I'm going to speak to you and keep going. Explain the difference between those two.
If an individual, now this was the premises on what I said that on. An individual asked the question, how do I know if I have forgiven this individual? And I make the statement, and I use that example. I said, now, if you see an individual struggling that has done you wrong, if you can pass by and leave them struggling, he getting what he deserved. You haven't forgiven him. But if you go out of your way to help that individual, now watch this. You go out of your way to help that individual get them out of a dangerous or a life-threatening situation. You have helped them because nothing in your heart is against them. Yet, when you help them, you don't have to take them home with you to eat dinner or anything like that. Because if you had not forgiven them, you see them in a bad predicament. And because that envy, that hurt, that pain is still there, you don't want to deal with them, period. Now, I got to love everybody, but I don't have to like them. Do you see the difference? That you just said it. They didn't deal with the individual. And then what sister, listen to what I'm saying. Then what Sister Hazel said, I said, Sister Hazel, I'm not gonna let you go because I got something I want to say. And she said, I'm gonna follow across the street. And she said, I wish you just gone back to the other side of the street. And there's a reason that I said that. Because number one, when conflict comes about, and we are going to have conflicts. If we avoid the situation, the issue is never dealt with. It's never dealt with. So when it comes to what Sister Jackie said, this individual has something he want to say, but I don't want to hear it. And the reason I don't hear it, I just want to deal with it. I'm going to speak to you. I'm going about my business. But they got something they need to say, they want to say. When it comes to the decision that we make, now Sister April said, I asked the question, who forgives the quickest, males or female? April said, males. My wife said it depends on situation.
The individuals.
Depends on the person. Depends on the situation. Wait. If you forgive in a little, you can forgive in a lot. But we cannot. We cannot. Now watch this here. And I'm trying to stay out of trouble. Who thinks logically, males or females? Huh? All right. I'm about to get in some trouble. I know how to do this. I know how to do it. Y'all shut up. Shut up. Deacon Curtis, who think logically?
Men. No, the Bible says silly women.
Deacon Curtis talking. Y'all shut up. What you say, Deacon? Uh-huh.
So it really depends on that person.
As a whole, who thinks logically?
Female.
Okay, I ain't gonna check it.
Man.
I'm gonna get somebody honest. Sister Shemiah, help me out, daughter. When it comes to college students, females that you have engaged with, do they make decisions based on logic or emotion when it comes to a young man?
Emotion.
They make, thank you. Thank you, hallelujah. Wait. Yes, sir. Y'all shut up. Listen.
He can sit down and think things through. A female said, well, we just need to do this.
Uh-huh.
So that's the situation. He said it's the person. Well, he said it's still a situation. It can be a different person. But he may react different in that situation than he did the next situation. So it's still a situation.
All right, let me go back to the street. Now, y'all got to be honest. Come here, sweetheart. Come here. Wait. Come here, Brooke. Give the Lord a hand for these young people. Now, same scenario, same situation. Two females have had a conflict 2 years past. Two males have had a conflict in 2 years past. They walking down the same street. They see each other. They're about to run into each other. Of the two situations, which one is most likely to cross to the other side of the street to avoid contact? Why? So is that based on emotion or logic? Thank you. Now. Wait, now, y'all asking the question. Don't y'all get mad at me. Watch this here. I'm speaking from life experience. Watch this here. Lord, let me wait till y'all get through talking. Now, see, I got some of the Bible classes going on in the midst of my Bible class. Y'all know y'all can't be. My wife is teaching April. I see other folk teaching. Woo.
Lord help us.
Woo. Help me. Sister Griffin, come up here. Get your first lady. Hold up. Yes, ma'am. You don't want to be re-depressed. You don't want to take that risk. Because 9 times out of 10, you think they really haven't changed, right? You don't want to reopen that door. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I mean, you back to who's thinks logic. The Bible calls the woman the weaker vessel for a reason, because she's, that's just Carolyn rolling her eyes at me. Tell her to turn back around. Because now, we're not saying that some men don't, you know, do it in certain instances. It shouldn't be.
We're talking about as a whole.
As a whole, the man thinks more logic.
Ooh, wait.
I got a perfect example.
Hold on. Y'all can't do this. Somebody got the floor.
So don't get mad at me. Get mad at the book, because it also say something about silly women too. But I'm just saying that's what the book says. So you can't get mad at me now. But the man thinks more logic. He was programmed to think logic from
now,
the beginning. So
the reason I'm speaking from a male perspective. The reason that the male would not go across the street, because in general, the male nature likes a challenge. Mm-hmm. It's in a male to protect. And I don't mean this in the wrong way. It's in a male to fight. It's in a male that when it comes to conflict, some of them go out their way to get in a good one. Yes. It's in their nature. Now watch this here. Watch this. And the Bible does say this here. Lord, I know I can't get away with it. Listen. Generally speaking, men make decisions based on logic. They're going to weigh the situation out. And this is one of the conflicts that females have with males, because a lot of times they leave the emotion totally out of it. I wish I could say what I want to say. I can't say it. I'm looking for a way to say it, but I can't say it. I can't.
It's children.
Huh? Men make decisions based on logic. It has not, it has very little to do with emotion. Now what? Jermaine and I had a conflict 2 years ago. We got to fight. Okay, like Ella Porter said, Jermaine the guy saved. He got something that he wants to say. Now, it doesn't matter to me whether he saved or lost. We had a conflict 2 years ago. When he comes and apologizes for that conflict, tell me he got saved, blah, 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 any guards that I have up, those guards are now down. You got to say, I'm going to respect that. Because he was man enough to come to me, and even though I may have been the aggressor, he was man enough to come to me on logical terms and say, man, you remember 2 years ago, blah, 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 blah. And guess what? We can become best friends based on logic. Lord, there are individuals in the past several months, and this question was asked. There are individuals in the past several months when it comes to conflict in the home, the husband and the wife. Okay, y'all can sit down right there, right for a minute. So y'all, it's been duly expressed that the females would go to the other side of the road to avoid the situation. In the past several months, there have been individuals that have come from different directions seeking counsel on conflict resolution. Female, how could you do that? You don't even know that person. You don't even know that person. The male, I didn't have to know him. It was just a incident. I didn't have to know him. Are y'all reading between the lines? This is this, and his psychic is that I didn't have to be in love with him. I didn't have to know him. I just complied with the request. Do you understand what I'm saying? So now, on his part, it's not right what he did. Because it wasn't no emotion involved. But on the other part, the individual's feelings were crushed. Their confidence was destroyed. And the bottom line is that we are not going to resolve this situation by ignoring it and pretending that it never happened. So when you run into me on the street, come here. Whether you run into me on the street or wherever, even before you can come and pray, if you have an unresolved issue, let the Lord tell you to do, both males and females, brothers and sisters, saints and Christian friends, even before you can come and pray, what does the scripture say do? Huh? Go to them. Now I'm just going to pray about it. I'm just going to pray about it. I'm just going to pray about it. Yes, ma'am.
Left it alone. Mm-hmm. So we can't just leave it alone. I mean, multiple. I mean, it was repeatedly. I did get upset. I did want to go off on some of them, but I did leave it alone. Mm-hmm. But I left it there. And now when I see them, it don't bother me, but I left it.
When you see them, can you interact with them?
Yes.
Okay, all right. You ain't got no problem. You got a problem. Now, in the event and conflicts are going to happen between brothers and sisters, church folk in the world, husband and wives, and situations are not resolved by just leaving them alone. And there are some issues that are hard to deal with. There was a lady, and she came up 2 weeks ago. There's an individual. You can have a seat for right now. There's an individual in Rankin County Correctional Facilities. He's doing life. He's a black man. Two of them, and some of you know this story, two of them broke in this white Pentecostal lady's home. She had a little girl. Was she 9 or 10? I think she was 9 or 10, somewhere in that age. The two black males that broke in her home, they raped this little girl, and she ended up dying. A year after this incident, her Pentecostal husband died as a result of a broken heart. I don't know what happened to the other black man in prison, but one of them is still living. What do y'all call that, commissary? There is an individual that keeps money on his books. He has one visitor that has come to visit him constantly. Guess who that one visitor is? That white lady that he killed her little girl. She not only lost her daughter, but she lost her husband. And was nothing physically wrong with the man, no cancer, no tuberculosis, no nothing like that. The doctor, he died of grief, died of a broken heart. So this white woman goes to this prison, puts money on this black man's, what do you call it? Commissary. She is his only, his relatives don't even come to visit him. The only visitor he have is an elderly white female that comes to visit him to talk to him all the time. And guess what happened as a result of that? That cat got saved. He's still in prison, but he got saved. And you know what caused him to get saved? The ability of an individual to forgive. In order for her to heal, she went to this individual and kept going and requesting to see him until he faced her face to face. And she sat down and she talked about her little girl. She told him about what happened after the trial, a year later, how she lost her husband. And she said basically to this black man, I had to forgive you in order for me to live. And with her forgiving him, it melted his heart of stone. He got baptized in Jesus' name. I don't know how they did it in the jail, but God filled him with the Holy Ghost. The power of forgiveness is wonderful. But watch this. Watch this here. Come right back one more time. When we make decisions from a human standpoint, from the human spirit, we will always find a justification for it. Hear me. When we make decisions from our human psychic, we will always find a justification for our actions. When we make decisions from our human psychic, and this is with the Holy Ghost, with the Holy Ghost, with the Holy Ghost, with the Holy Ghost, we find a way to justify our action because it feels justifiable to the human. Am I making sense? But the Bible tells us, be ye transformed by the what? Renewing of your mind. Now, in order for me to renew my mind against this individual from 2 years ago, I got to change out that data. I have to allow that door to be open, because you ever heard garbage in, garbage out? Whatever you put in is what you get out. If I still got the same data, I'm still holding on to the same thoughts, the same emotion, the same conflict that we had 2 years ago, and I have not given this individual a chance to say, and he may not have changed, but what if he has changed? Now, the scripture tells us this. And God got a way, God got a way, God got a way of helping us with his word if we will allow the word of God to rest, rule, and abide in our hearts at all times. The psalmist has said, thy word, O God, have I what? Hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. Because what you feel in your human psychic, it has nothing to do with the word of God. But it's 90% of our decision-making influence, how we feel about a situation. So what does God do with our feeling? Talk, folk. What does God do with our feeling? In order for me to allow some different data in, I have to allow this individual to express himself, even at the risk of my own feelings. Hallelujah. The risk of my own feelings. Risk of my own feelings. Yes, ma'am. All right. Yeah. Yes. Watch this, sister. Watch this, sister. Sister Ida. Jamar and I headed in the same direction. You run the risk that nothing has changed, and if nothing has changed, you run the risk of the old wounds being reopened. And if the old wounds reopen, and you have interaction with this individual, you were having a beautiful day, but now you're feeling bad because you go back to what happened 2 years ago. That ruined your whole day. Right? So now, something happened to cause both of y'all to be on the same street at the same time. Something. A lot of us say it was coincidence. I don't believe anything happened in life except God permitted. Except God permitted. So now, when it comes to the human psyche, when we make our decisions, brothers and sisters, a lot of individuals have missed deliverance because they made a decision based on what they felt about the issue. Watch this. What's that eternal part of you? Your soul. What resonates or relates to the word of God? Your soul. What rejects the word of God? The flesh. Watch this. An individual came to Jesus. You can sit down for a minute. An individual came to Jesus and said, "Good master, we know that thou, the teacher, come from God." What did Jesus say? "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but the what? Father." So now, watch this. Woo! Watch this, young folk. Watch this. Your soul is the thing that connects with the word of God. That's why when a word comes forth, you don't even have to have the Holy Ghost for the word of God to move you. Y'all don't believe that, do you? You don't. If you had to have the Holy Ghost for the word of God to move you, none of us would be saved. Because when we heard the word of God, we didn't have no Holy Ghost. But it resonated with our soul. And when it resonated with our soul, the heart was forced to start beating faster. What happens when your heart starts to get fast? You get excited or you get scared or something that's going on. That's why a lot of times, the Bible tells us that God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of love, of power, and of sound mind. Your soul is the thing that's in love with God. Your soul is the only good thing about, let me say this, our soul is the only good thing about us. Our soul. It don't make no difference if he's 6'9", with hair as black as a raven feathers, as curly as Shirley Temple's hair, with green eyes, and driving a Porsche. You better look at his soul before you look at his body. Hallelujah. Ooh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm just throwing something out there. If you want to know how deep a person is, read the telltale signs. You want to know how deep they are? Read the tell. I'm so glad I didn't have no daughter. Hallelujah. She would have been unapproachable. Because number one, the first time a young man, I ain't going to say what I want. The first time a young man showed up at my door with earrings on, I done read you already. The first time a young man show up with earrings on, and guess what? If he do show up and ain't got no earrings on, I'm going to follow him to the car, see what type of music he listening to. And if he turn the radio off, I'm going to say, turn the radio back on. I'm going to check him out, Robert. Yes, sir. Woo! Who don't have a chance? See that? I just told y'all. Y'all be teaching Bible class while I'm teaching. And I'm so glad folk be listening. Thank you. Go ahead.
Can be slick as a snake.
Yes, sir.
You can have a clean cut and you be full of the devil.
I'm finna get there. I'm fixing to get there.
So we try to tell them the first thing they need to look at. When somebody asked me about this dude, I say, I have not heard anything about him coming sitting down on these pews.
Uh-huh.
Well, I still haven't seen him. You will understand that guy when you start talking about God and the Bible and see how he react to that.
Yeah.
Watch that.
Yes. Let me. I was fixing. You beat me to the punch. Watch this. Watch this. Read. Watch this. You gotta read. Lord have mercy. God gives us everybody, every human being, even before you get saved, you should have a certain amount of discernment. All snakes don't hiss. Some of them said, praise the Lord.
Yes.
They will shout, dance, and jump over a pew.
Yes.
But you got to learn to read the telltale sign. Now, I'm talking about from the streets. From the street, individual may have dreads, may have earrings, tattoos, pants hanging off his rear end. You know he got a spirit of work. But he could be a diamond in the rough. Now, this is crazy. This crazy to tell an individual you can't talk to an individual because he ain't got the Holy Ghost. That's crazy. You can talk to anybody. But you got to know how for to take it. You got to know how to take it. Because number one, you've heard those saying, you can't judge a book by its cover. But begin to turn them pages one page at a time. Read. Ask questions. Hear the response. Because back to here, we make decisions based on stored data. There can be an individual that looks exactly like this young man. Same height, same build, same everything, dressed the same, but they have two different spirits. The physical features are going to change, but the character of that individual will remain untouched for the most part. I would fight before I got saved. Some of y'all would too. I would fight before I got saved. Lord, some of the saints said, they still will. Help us, Jesus. When it comes to character traits, the Bible tells you train up a child in the way that he should go. I don't have to be saved to be truthful. When it comes to making decisions, watch this here. If you listen to an individual, the best way to determine what's there, if an individual talks long enough, they're going to tell you where they are. You're going to find out what they think, what they believe, where they're coming from. It's inevitable. You listen to them. Let them talk. But sometimes we be so busy talking, we don't take time to listen. You got to listen. And when it comes to an individual, even if he apologizes and does not mean it, guess what? You got to forgive him. You do. He don't mean that. Okay. You got to find me a scripture that says if he mean it. You remember the scripture? Individual came to Jesus. Lord, how often, you can sit down for a minute, shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Seven times? You talking about in one day now? He said, no. But until 70 times 70. Who in their right mind going to do the same thing 490 times in the same day? Who? Ooh, hallelujah. You got to be stone crazy. But even if they're stone crazy, the Lord said, they say, forgive me. Forgive you for what? For making that ugly face at you. And they're going to do it again. You still got to forgive them. Guess what? Come on, son, sit right here again. Lord have mercy. This is perfect example. Ooh. Now this is a commercial side slot. Commercial side slot. This is not for y'all out there in radio land. This is just for Apostolic Restoration Ministry only. All of last year, I stood in the pulpit. I said, hallelujah. I don't know how we're going to do it, but the Lord going to bless us to get this temple restored. Didn't I not say that? Give the Lord a hand praise. I say, everybody interested in helping out, we need a decorating committee, we need a paint committee, all of this here, volunteer your time. How many of y'all remember saying that? A few weeks ago, I said, the pew man is coming to town. He will be here Tuesday at 6 o'clock to do the presentation. Everybody that want to come, come. How many of y'all remember me saying that? Guess how many folks showed up? A handful. Saints meeting Monday night. I showed the pews. I showed the colors. Are they qualified to pick the colors? Who picked them? Ooh. Lord, help me, Jesus. Ooh. Ooh. I didn't know what to say. But the Lord gave me an answer today. Bring me the mic. The Lord gave me an answer today. Who? Give me the answer the Lord gave you, daughter. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand praise. I don't know. But guess what the Lord say? This is what the Lord say. He said, if you don't, what's your name, son? If I don't give Jermaine for killing my dog, God will not forgive me for killing somebody's cat when I was 16 years old. He won't. He'll go back in the past and dig up some stuff that you did. Yeah, he did this when he was 16. Put that right back on his plate. And you'll spend eternity paying for it. When it comes to us making decisions, what we got to learn to do is put the flesh behind us. How can you be in the flesh and put it behind you? Step outside of yourself. How do you do that? How do you step outside of yourself? Turn the fans off. Lord have mercy. When it comes to making decisions, your decisions, every decision that we make must be based on the word of God. Got to. It has to emanate, stand up, from the soul. Your eternal soul is that part of you that resonates with the Spirit of God. Your eternal soul, when your soul makes a decision, no matter how hard it is, you are going to do what thus saith the Lord. Watch this. Your soul does not get disappointed when you don't get what you ask God for. This gets disappointed. Your emotions get the best of you. And when this gets the best of you, you ignore your soul and you listen to your spirit and sit down. Watch this. When you listen to your human intellect, your human psychic, it overrides that God part of you. You know what Paul said? When it comes to sin, he that is born of God does not do what? What you mean? What you mean he does not sin? I don't believe there's anybody in the church that has gotten saved and has not gone astray. So what is it talking about? He cannot sin, but yet the seed remain in him. Help me out, somebody. Help me out. Lord, I ain't got no help up in here. The seed remain in him. Stand up. You were still in a body of flesh. No man is tempted. Your soul, that eternal part of you that is going to spend eternity with God. Once you are redeemed, you are washed in the blood of the Lamb, filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What do you mean? Let the Spirit of God rule. Hear God from your soul. When you hear God from your soul, you can override the flesh. Even if it hurts. Jesus made the statement, Father, let this cup do what? Pass from me. Nevertheless, who's speaking? Let this cup pass from me. But the soul come right back. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. It feels justifiable. It feels ease. It relaxes your emotion. When you make a decision based on the flesh and it seems justifiable, because you do get tired. You get tired of folk pushing on. You get tired of folks pinching. You get tired of folks saying other things and all of these things. But your soul is that God part of you that God is most concerned about giving your soul a word. When God give your soul a word, you can go through hell and not feel the flames of the fire because you're not caught up in the flesh. What happens a lot of times when we make decisions based on the flesh, we give in to what we feel. When we give in to what we feel, we become defeated. It's just like trying to fight the devil with fists. Doing what? Trying to fight the devil with fists. Trying to be an overcomer in the flesh and not letting the spirit rest, rule, and abide. The scripture says, as a man thinketh, so is he. When it comes to us, brothers and sisters, the mandate that God has given us, there's a song that says, my soul loves Jesus. My soul loves Jesus. My soul loves Jesus. And do what? Bless his name. You know what the song goes to say? He's a wonder in my soul. He's a wonder in my soul. Now watch what happens. When we make the difference, when we differentiate, when we put the divine in line, and the word of God must be rightly divided. Ooh. There's a portion of the word of God that speaks to you on the fleshly level. It is. There's a portion of the word of God that speaks solely in terms of the flesh. Did y'all know that? I know somebody had to know that. How many didn't know that? You didn't know that? Sister Kelly, yes. 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 There's a part of the word of God that caters to the flesh, the natural man. Mm-hmm. I hope y'all, huh? Yes, sir. Come on. Talking to the flesh. For this cause shall a man leave his mother and his father and shall cleave unto his wife, and there shall be what? One flesh. The Bible says, Jesus, I come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Now, if we only had hope of eternal life, then for afterlife, we would be of all men most miserable. The Bible tells us that the earth is the what? And the fullness. What else did it say? And they that dwell there, everything belongs to the Lord. So now, when it comes to the wealth of the world, the Bible says that the wealth of the wicked is laid up for who? Laid up for the just. Your soul don't need no money. But your flesh do. Your flesh needs some money. You have to keep it clean. You have to keep it healthy. You have to keep it fed. You have to keep it dressed. It takes money. Talk to the flesh. So now, when it comes to us, things that address the flesh, but hallelujah, by paying your tithes and offering, it not only blesses your soul in being obedient to God, but it blesses your flesh. How does it bless your flesh? Because when you become obedient to the word of the Lord, God is going to supply all of your natural need according to his riches in glory. We've got to get past making decisions based on what we feel at the moment, because your feelings are going to change as soon as you calm down. Hallelujah. Your feelings are going to change. And guess who has to administrate that change? Huh? The people of God. Ooh, I got a hard question. Who wants to answer it? Who wants to answer it? I got a hard question. Who wants to answer it? Huh? I said it's a hard question. Who wants to answer it? Okay. I need a break. Sister Deborah says she wants to answer. Now, Sister Deborah, watch this. Jesus made this statement. He said, the works that I do, you're going to do what? Did Jesus mean that? Huh?
Yes.
Jesus meant that statement?
Yes.
All right. How did he send them out?
By two.
He sent them out two by two. All right? Jermaine and I are on a mission. Jermaine and I are on a mission. I need somebody married. Sit down for a minute. Come here, Brother Robert. Be a married man. Give the Lord a hand praise for Brother Robert. Brother Robert is a married man. He just got married. They ain't been married but 2 years. Praise the Lord. He has a bouncing 9-pound baby boy named Taekwondo. Now watch this. Get your hand out your pocket, Brother Robert. We out witnessing. I get a call. There's a shootout down the street. And the Lord speak to me and tell me that Carlos is down there involved in that shootout, to go down there and get him. Now, we're two by two. Robert and his wife ain't been married but 2 years. My children are grown. Do I have the right to take Robert with me into that situation? Now, I told y'all to raise your hand. Sister Deborah, only one raise a hand. Rest of y'all, shut up. Oh, Sister Deborah, raise a hand. Do I have the right, Sister Deborah?
Yes, if God say so.
Huh?
Yes, if God say so.
Wait. No. God didn't, Robert and I are on a mission. The Bible tells us, do whatsoever your hands find to do as unto the Lord. I get the call that Carlos is in a shootout down the street. He and I are together. He and I are together. My son is in trouble. Do I have the right? My children are grown. He just had a 9-pound baby boy. Do I have the right to take him to that situation?
The Bible says in all their ways acknowledge him. So that means he may not be qualified to go. It could be you and somebody else.
Deborah,
sorry.
They are in a shootout. I don't have time for no hour and a half prayer. We in the car. I got a choice to do one or two things. Stop and put him out, or drive right on down there with him in the car with me. Yes, sir. That's what I'm saying. God didn't tell me to take Robert with him. Okay, I'm going to ask Robert. Robert, you want to go with me?
Yeah.
service of Jesus. Woo. Bonnie, you see this? Now, watch this. Watch this. There are times when you need an instant answer from God that he don't say nothing. Because he want to see what you're going to do. There are times, brothers and sisters, that you need an instant answer from God because he wants to see what you're going to do. Not that he don't hear you, but he going to see what you're going to do. Now, Robert said, nope. Do I have the right to take Robert with me? Do I have the right? Come on. Just don't tell him how Sister Griffin. Woo. Sister Griffin. I'm going to have to walk you to your car after church. Yes. I'm going to tell him. I'm going to tell him. Yes, sir. Uh-huh.
You had a right.
Uh-huh.
And the reason I say that you had a right, if you tell Robert that you were finna go, and Robert is living the way that he's supposed to live, he had to lay down his life, would pick up his life.
Ooh. Elder Walker, what should I do? Let him out.
Let me put it like this. If you got a person that's, you a fighter, and you got a person that's not a fighter, you better take somebody with you that's another fighter.
But see, in this situation, Robert is full of zeal, but he don't have the knowledge that I have. He's young. He ain't been married but 2 years. He has a 9-pound baby boy, 2 weeks old, at the house. A young wife. Mm-hmm. So now, if I go and Robert gets shot and I come out, Robert gets shot.
Both of them.
And I come out unhurt. I got to deal with Miss Robert for the rest of my saved life. And guess what she got to do? She got to forgive me. She got to forgive me.
She's supposed to forgive you.
Huh?
She's supposed to forgive you.
But she in the church, she got to forgive me.
There's a lot of people in the church that hadn't forgave, so she's supposed to.
You know why? The reason they haven't forgiven us, Deborah, because they justified according to the way that they feel in their flesh.
Mm-hmm.
There are some hard situations. And when I said there are some hard situations, unforgiveness is not an option. When your soul loves Jesus, you forgive in spite of, not because of. How do I forgive in spite of, not because of? I got to crucify the flesh. You got to crucify the flesh. Because flesh will always give you a reason not to forgive. And guess what? Some of y'all would help Miss Robert not to forgive. You will. You would tell Sister Robert, Pastor know better than that. Yes, you will. Y'all would tell Sister Robert, he know better than that. And you got this baby to raise all on your own. Lord, I'm just going to pray. Now, you just sowing discord. And your prayers already block in, Sister Crystal. Pastor know better than that. Because you don't know what the Lord told me. You know what the Lord told me. It might have been the Lord's will for Robert to write down to give me a shot in the leg. Yes, ma'am. You can forgive and not forget.
Because every time you see that person, it brings it back. And
you can truly forgive an individual and not forget. Every time this woman goes to Rankin County, she sees the man that raped her 9-year-old daughter. How can she not think about her baby? She's going to take this man $25, $30 to be able to buy soap, a bag of chips, a honey bun for the month. How can she not? She keeps going. That's not her obligation. But guess what? It has to be the love of God. She got the genuine Holy Ghost to go and take this man $25 every month to put on his company and sit down and talk to the man. You don't have to forgive. You don't have to forget to forgive. Because some things you remember till the day you die. And brothers and sisters, when it comes to the flesh, discord is so easily sown because you can relate to what the person feel because of past experience with somebody else. Honey, I know how you feel. Instead of putting that individual in their place, you side with them. You listen to them. And watch this. They drop off spirits in your home that you don't even know that they are there. She knows. Pastor know better than to take that young brother down there. If he wanted to go get shot, let him go get his old tail shot up. Kick that young brother. That's what they say. That's what they say, Sister Porter. That's what they say. Yes. Huh? Now see, I ain't gonna tell you about your cousin. Yes, ma'am. Huh? Because I have an ear to hear. I have an ear to hear. And guess what? If I listen to folk, my ear will become dull to what thus saith the Lord. Because God tell me some things I would never tell y'all because y'all would think I'm stone crazy. You would. You think Sister Chris, they would think I'm stone crazy. Yes, they would. Can I call his name? Battlefield. Oh, okay. Let me say this here. I'm not going to call no name. Right. I can. There is an individual well known, can I just say, throughout Jackson? Throughout Jackson. And they think everybody, Sister Johnson, is just alike. So, the Lord will allow you to be tried. The Lord will allow you. These individuals, they don't think nobody's saved. So he had a big gathering over by Battlefield on a Saturday. All the big fancy cars were there. A lot of folks were there. Unchurched people were there. 2 o'clock in the daytime, and the sun was shining bright, and the music was banging from one street to the other. I finally found me a parking space because the leader invited Pastor Porter to come to his gala event. They had barbecue galore and I ain't gonna say live entertainment. They had it all laid out. A spirit told me to go. I went. Yes. Was it the spirit of the Lord? How you know? Huh? I did say a spirit. I asked you, was it the spirit of the Lord? You said, mm-mm. I said, how you know? No, I presented exactly the way I wanted to present it. Because, see, we make decisions based on supposition. Hallelujah. Glory to God. See how they don't be listening? A spirit told me to go. Was it the spirit of the Lord? Help me how? I got you, I got you, I got you. He had the money. And guess what? He had the money. Yes. And he had the money. And what does God judge in everything we do? He judges our motive. Now, my motive for taking Robert with me, I'm going into a shootout. The Bible said two are better than one. Don't it? Two, if one can chase 1,000, two can chase 10,000. So, what if my motive for going in this situation taking a saved brother that we can join hands and pray? What if that's my motive? Do I have the right to take Robert? What if my motive for going into that situation which Carlos is in a shootout so that once we get there, Robert and I can join hands and pray because two can put 10,000 to flight? So if that's my motive, is it all right to take him? Was his motive right? Okay, hold that thought right there. Yes. All right. Now, listen to this. Y'all listen to this. Sister April brought up the situation where what's his name? Uzzah. Yes, Uzzah. Uzzah touched the ark and died of a massive stroke. She said his motive was right. If his motive was right, then what was wrong? How can your motive be right in disobedience? Woo! Here we go back to the flesh. Here we go back to the flesh. Your flesh will justify your motive to be disobedient. The Lord know how I feel. God just going to have to give me strength. No, he don't. You telling God what he got to do. He tell you be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You saying, Lord, give me strength. Pray my strength in the Lord. Pray your own strength in the Lord. You asking God to do what he told you to do. He said, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Stop thinking the way that you've always thought and start thinking differently. What was wrong with Uzzah's motive? Folk, come on, come on. How was it contrary to the word? Watch this here. Uzzah had what you call a wicked alliance. Uzzah had a wicked alliance. He went along with wrongdoing, not considering his own safety. And when something went foul, he tried to prevent it, and he didn't have the power or the right to do that. Wicked alliances, you go along with wrongdoing because you don't want to hurt the other person's feeling. Watch this. You go along with wickedness. It ain't my business. It's them doing it. But you condoning it by being silent. Folk know who to call when they want to spread gossip. They know who not to call. And they call you like a snake. Well, you know the Lord blessed us. I often wonder. wondered about Uzzah for years. I read this scripture and I asked God, why God killed a man? He's trying to keep the ark from stumbling over in the water. How many know the answer? Did he do the right thing? Uzzah shouldn't have been there in the first place. He was out of place. He was in the wrong place at the wrong time, and they were doing the wrong thing. How were they doing the wrong thing? Number one, you have to be careful how you handle the word of God. Everybody's not qualified to give you a word of God. We got parking lot pastors here and internet pastors. Everybody got a word from the Lord but your own pastor. And when the pastor give a word that's contrary to their word, who word you going to go with? Hallelujah. Girl, the Holy Ghost gave you that. Yes, it did. Ooh, God is an awesome God. Number one, let me show you what was out of order. The ark of God was so precious. Priests had to be sanctified. When they transported the ark, they had to build a ramp. Four men, two on the front, two on the back. They had to pick that ramp up and put it on their shoulders and march in order and go so many paces and start saying, God is a good God. Yes, he is. Blessings, honor, glory, and power be unto the name of the Lord. Then they go another place. God is a good God. Yes, he is. Blessings and honor be unto the name of the Lord. But guess what they did? You know why that ark stumbled? Wasn't no four men carrying it. Cows were pulling it on a cart behind cows. And cows don't have no bathroom manners. They use the bathroom wherever they want to, whenever they have to. But you got the ark being pulled on a sled behind cows when it was supposed to be up on a pedestal on four individuals' shoulders, walking a certain number of paces and singing the songs of Zion. Uzzah went along with it because David told him to bring it. Nobody took the time to make sure things were done decently and in order. The word of God is so precious. Folk ain't gonna miss heaven because they have to. They're gonna miss it because they ignore the word of the Lord. That's why God say, I will give you pastors after mine own heart. Ooh, I got a word from the Lord. Real pastors gonna catch hell, but they gonna get some good folk to heaven. Because they ain't gonna mind the hell they gotta go through. Because somebody gonna be saved. You know why? Somebody gonna listen. They gonna take heed to the word of God. They gonna plant that word of God in their soul. And they gonna respond in time, in kind. My point is this. It don't make no difference to God how you feel in your flesh. Your flesh will get you in trouble. I know some wonderful men and women in Zion. Wonderful men and women in Zion. Got caught up in a bad situation because, ooh, he got such nice curly hair. He makes $75,000 a year. And Lord bless, he's driving a Camry, Toyota, my dream car, hallelujah. He ain't got no children, bless the Lord. He's got to be mine, Lord. Now you telling the Lord he got to be mine, but the Lord ain't told you that. Ooh, let me stop. I'll be the messed up this whole Bible class. Have a seat, Robert. Are there any questions? Yes, sir. Yeah, come on, son. Say this, hold on just a minute. Get a young man a mic. Yeah.
Instead.
He said, Reed, come on.
Instead of.
Y'all shut up.
Instead of praying to Jesus, asking for the man, they said that they didn't have an ear to hear what the Lord was saying. They were thinking that they was using the ear of the flesh, not of the blood.
Lord, have mercy. Thank you, Jesus. They be listening with an ear of flesh, huh? Lord, have mercy. Flesh and blood, then get it to you, son. That's Sister Crystal's son. Give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah. Y'all better stop listening to the ear of flesh. You better listen to the Spirit of the Lord. Boy, God is an awesome God. I often think of Isaiah Nichols. This little fellow, 5 years old. I knew he had the gift of prophecy. Don't have the Holy Ghost yet, but he got a gift of prophecy. That Friday night, he went to his grandmother and told his grandmother, somebody shoot Mark. That Saturday night, less than 24 hours later, just exactly what he told his grandmother, he told him exactly where they shot Mark, and that's how they found him. That five-year-old told her the day before. Several weeks ago, on a Monday night, they were on the way to prayer. Reggie was driving. He was pushing Reggie to hurry up, drive fast, drive. He said, what's wrong? What's wrong? He said, the angel is already there. And the angel was in this house that Monday night. Somebody said, hallelujah. Three prophecies, this little fellow said, and every one of them were true to form. There are gifts in your children. There are gifts in your children. And watch this here. Some individuals going to lose their spiritual inheritance because they're more concerned about the tradition of men than the word of God. They rather die in the wilderness than come to the light of day where those gifts can be perfected. Brothers and sisters, don't let that be. Find and fulfill your God-given destiny. Give the Lord a praise in this house. Are there any questions? I didn't get to but one of my scriptures. But the Lord said the same. We're going to pick this up here. And the title is A Call from Within. God be speaking to our soul all the time.